Yo te estoy ofreciendo una gran oportunidad para que crezcas.
Behind the whole thing.
I told you, this thing is bigger than Nino Brown, and I gotta listen to it. If I'm going down, I'm taking a whole lot of people with me.
Order in the court.
Yo, yo, hip hop legal in full effect. Yo, don't be like Nino Brown. Now, the theatrics may get you a standing ovation in the state courts, and maybe along with a nice contribution to a judge out here, might get you off.
Mr. Hilton, are you the second coming of our savior?
Excuse me?
Are you Jesus Christ come back to earth?
See you at sentencing.
I'm kidding, by the way. Maybe I'm not. But when it comes to the feds, they don't play around this whole crime of conspiracy thing, which is what we're going to be covering today in our first segment of Law Lessons. Let's get it. So look, my rationale for doing this, my reasoning for doing this, is to pay it forward, man. And that's what I ask out of you. If you're listening to this and it interests you, you appreciate it, make sure to like, subscribe, turn on the notification bell, follow me on all social media, like, subscribe it there, and share. You know, it's mad entities out here that are keeping their fingers crossed, hoping that you stay ignorant. And the truth of it is, many folks will remain ignorant and essentially line themselves up to become another tragic statistic ensnared in the criminal justice system in America. And make no mistake about it, there are mad individuals in there behind those bars that are kicking themselves saying, damn, I wish I would have really done my research and known what I was getting into. Because the worst feeling in the world is to be sitting back thinking, damn, I'm about to do all this time because of my ignorance or because of my association with ignorant or unsavory characters. Anyway, on its face, that is prima facie. Check out your boy with the legalese. On its face, criminal conspiracy is when you plan with other people to engage in criminal activity. Period. That said, the law can create certain complexities or nuances, if you will, that come into question, such as when does something go from being simply talking to actually being concrete and in place, making it a conspiracy that is punishable. And we also have to consider the First Amendment of the United States Constitution and how conspiracy applies to the ability to have free speech. The punishment for conspiracy is essentially a way of keeping criminals from being organized, as well as holding accountable all of the parties that are involved in criminal activity. Fair warning, I'm going to get into some heavy legal talk. You can fast forward, or you can check it out if you're that kind of nerd. But listen, when it comes to conspiracy is, and this is similar to attempt, as well as criminal solicitation, conspiracy is an inchoate crime. You may be asking yourself, what's inchoate? Well, now look, it's important that you get your pens out right now. This is, I think, the biggest part of this and the purpose for me doing this is because a lot of folks miss this point. Inchoate means that the criminal result did not necessarily have to happen for liability to be attached and for it to be a conspiracy. What does that mean? You get the call that your boy want some merchandise. We'll call it that. You call up your other homeboy and say that the one homeboy needs some merchandise. Now, something happens where it don't really go through, but somebody get booked along the way. All they got to do is mention that, yeah, I called him and he called the other dude. And you are thrown into a conspiracy case. It's that simple. You'd be surprised how many times this happens. That's why the truth of it is, if you have friends, make sure they're upstanding citizens, or at least folks that won't ever implicate you in anything wrong that they're doing. You did, because, again, you know, the deal didn't even have to go through. The actual criminal result does not have to take place for the liability to be attached. Now, I've attached a couple great diagrams here on the screen, full of pictures and really thorough. This one here pertains specifically to the elements and defenses involved. Now, again, it breaks down the solicitation, accomplice, conspiracy, and attempt, but we're talking specifically about conspiracy. So that being the case, what is necessary for conspiracy to be labeled a conspiracy is the agreement. Now, again, the agreement is something that you should put a star next to, highlight, write it in red, because this is the most important part of the conspiracy. In fact, in certain jurisdictions, to be charged with conspiracy, all that is required is to form an agreement to commit a crime. So literally, a handshake. The agreement doesn't even have to be formal. It can be inferred based off of the circumstances. And so this gives the court room, that is latitude, to find a conspiracy from the circumstances surrounding the completed crime. So take a second to wrap that around your brain. What that means is that even if there is no evidence of actual verbalization or a paper trail of the plot, just be somebody's words, somebody that's implicated. That's why, again, be careful who you associate with. Now, get this, the agreement, even if the underlying goal of the agreement cannot be accomplished, and I'll give you an example in a second, but because it's physically impossible, an individual or individuals can still be charged with conspiracy. So what does that mean? Let's say in this case, Marlo meeting with Sergey. Sergey could possibly get murked on the inside as soon as he steps away from this meeting. Let's say Marlo was able to broker a deal right before he stepped away. Technically, Marlo has initiated a conspiracy to distribute whatever drugs they were talking about. And really, Avon could possibly reach out to a prosecutor in Baltimore to implicate Marlo in that conspiracy, even though Sergey is not even alive. Again, as long as the agreement happens and the conspiracy is on, even if it can't be accomplished or it's physically impossible. Now, the general consensus in America is that you need at least two parties to form a conspiracy. Now, again, at least two, so it could be two or more. But the country is pretty much split when it comes to whether both parties need to have guilty minds, is what they call it. And again, these are technical aspects of the law, but the questions come about as to whether there was a bilateral or unilateral approach to the conspiracy, meaning if both sides have to be in agreement, or one can simply be in agreement when it comes to dealing with, for example, an undercover cop. These are issues that, you know, they wrangle over in the courts a lot. Now, let's talk about the overt act component that is necessary according to most jurisdictions. Now, this is a requirement that an actual crime be committed by at least one member of the conspiracy. It must be an action that is for the furtherance of the legal objective. So in this case, I'm using, again, The Wire. Peapod Marlowe is meet with Avon, but he had planned to meet with Sergey. What happened is Sergey didn't really trust Marlowe. So Avon, being as connected as he is, somehow became the middleman in between their deal, which Avon did make some money off of. But this is what I'm talking about when it comes to conspiracy, and how Avon, by simply placing himself in the middle of this whole thing here, is culpable and is as guilty as Marlowe or Sergey. Now, again, what if this is a deal for 5,000 keys? So Avon will end up doing 5,000 keys worth of time. Now, I don't think the money that he got just trying to facilitate this whole interaction was worth it. No money is ever really worth it if you think about it. This is in its simple form how someone can be involved. Now, again, that overt act, if it didn't go through, for example, if Marlowe didn't show up the next time and actually met with Sergey, and we don't have an overt act. Or, for example, if Sergey and Marlowe actually just spoke about things and didn't actually get the merchandise in their respective hands, then you don't necessarily have that overt act. But again, it really depends on the jurisdiction, because the conversation can be viewed as the way that the agreement was met or set by both parties, and then you have a conspiracy. Depending on the state, again, there are various nuances that could make it go either way in terms of whether charges can even be brought up. And if we're talking about the federal level, obviously, it's just a matter of presenting it to a grand jury, which, if you didn't know, they can actually convict a ham sandwich. Now, I wanted to talk about a component that I think is very interesting, and it will apply to a couple of things I'm going to post after this particular post, but it has to do with the illegal object component.
Now, most jurisdictions require a specific illegal object for there to be a crime of conspiracy. However, some states make it a crime to conspire, even to perform legal activities where the object of the plan is to engage in behavior that would be harmful to the public health. Again, harmful to the public health. Let's remember that. A good example would be, let's say, a group of professional black women, for example, decide to engage in planning in how they estimate they will attempt to destroy black men by using their positions of power, whether it be the fact that they're judges, they're lawyers, they're doctors, to harm black men. While they may not be stating the specific way that they will engage in a statutory criminal act, having that conversation, clearly showing that there's an intent there, and being in a position of power where they can, get certain things done, in my opinion, could be considered injurious to the public health. And again, you're simply doing it based off of a person's race. It's a strange example, I know, but it'll make sense soon. But to be clear, though, while it may not necessarily prompt an arrest, just based off of what I'm stating, there's obviously the civil rights component, which is another conversation, but it does bring up the point that maybe there needs to be an investigation to find out specifically what an individual may have in mind in terms of the public health harm component. But just to be clear, conspiracy does require the specific intent component, which means that the defendant must act with a specific goal in mind. Both parties need to intend to agree on a plan to commit an act. They must intend to achieve the illegal goal of the conspiracy. Now, if either of these intents is missing, the defendants cannot be charged with conspiracy on its face. And this one gets a little iffy in my opinion, because using the previous example with the black women that have decided to conspire to create a plan or various plans to harm black men, one can argue, one of those individuals within that call can say, hey, I was just kidding. You know, I didn't mean anything that I said. And then in some instances, depending on if they're believable or if the amount of plausible deniability that they invoke or spew out works, then they can avoid being charged with conspiracy. Now, that doesn't mean the other individuals aren't liable in that same scenario. Now, this depends on whether that particular jurisdiction uses the or subscribes to the unilateral approach, which again only requires a single guilty mind for it to be a conspiracy. Close it out and then get straight to the point. Be careful who you fucking with. Keep your circle tight. You dig? Now, while conspiracy again is a complex crime, there are common denominators that are required for it to be considered a conspiracy. So obviously we mentioned agreement, as you can see here in the chart, and then we have you have to have the intent to agree, and then you have to have the intent to achieve the objective of said agreement, and that objective obviously should be illegal. And then you have the aspect of there needing to be at least one overt act in furtherance of the conspiracy. Now again, this is for, I think, officially being charged, but when you talk about investigations and maybe lighting a fire under certain individuals, because in the age of there being so many federal or state level informants out there, you gotta be on point, man. Wake up, man. Let them fool you. Ain't nothing wrong with being woke, especially when you fall into a certain demographic in this system. It happens far too often that, again, you just don't want to sign yourself up to be another statistic. And again, it's mad simple to get caught up in something like this. All it takes is someone calling up your phone and you deciding to answer, and then them even implying you know, that there's a transaction or some sort of connection that they need you to make. And sometimes what happens is if they really want to play dirty with you, they'll hear you say a word, but then they'll, you know, say that what you were trying to say was some hood vernacular, some street terminology that actually means something nefarious. So if you say chicken, they can imply that chicken means a kilogram of blank. You dig? And that's how sometimes, you know, listen, they play. And so it's only right that I give you a heads up, man, especially for my young brothers out there. Stay out the way. Be great. And really only rock with people that want you to be great and that can help you be great. And you can also help them be great. I'll try to do another one at some point, breaking down the difference between a federal conspiracy versus how the state play. Anyway, I love you. Stay safe. Don't let them box you in. Like, subscribe, follow, share, all of the above. Fuck with me. Hip Hop Legal. Gia.